Hi guys, Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive, and today we're taking a look at the old glory Jared James Nichols signature Les Paul from our friends at Epiphone. For those of you who aren't aware, Jared James Nichols is a fast rising star in the world of blues and rock guitar playing, and he is primarily known for playing exclusively with his fingers. Now in the intro, you heard me playing with a pick. Let's listen to how this guitar sounds through exactly the same settings, but using some fingers on the right hand instead. So now that we've listened to some high gain playing examples with a pick and with fingers, let's take a look at some spec. Now, of course, we'll listen to some more sedate playing examples in just a moment, but I do want to talk about the specifications, starting as per usual at the headstock end. So starting here at the headstock, we have Epiphone's traditional headstock shape and logo with this lovely kind of Les Paul custom split diamond inlay. If we turn things over, you will notice we've got the only bit of signature-itis that you're gonna see on this guitar. I love that they've chosen to put this on the back of the headstock rather than on the front, because it's a really cool guitar with a unique feature set that you can't find anywhere outside of the custom shop. So it's great that it doesn't have signatures plastered all over it, which is really rather cool. I like this little shock of cream white as well. There's Jared's signature on there, made in China. Now China have been producing some phenomenal guitars of late, and this is definitely one of them. Another cool appointment are these genuine Grover tuners, which are just like the ones that folks would replace the tuners on their old Les Paul customs with. They have an 18-to-1 ratio, so they're a very, very positive feeling tuner. Real nice appointment on a guitar as affordable as this one. I won't mention price yet, but I'm going to encourage you to drop it into your favorite search engine and see just how affordable this guitar is. Now the neck is a mahogany neck with an ebony fretboard, so real serious kosher tone woods going on here, especially again at this affordable price point. But it is, I'm going to show you this right now, this is a big manful neck. It's a serious handful. Now I've had the pleasure of meeting Jared a couple of times. He's a great guy, real pleasure to talk to, proper gentleman, but I'm a little, maybe that much under 6'3", and Jared towers over me. He's a huge dude with huge hands, and this neck reflects that. Now, the frets themselves, while they're really quite thick and quite broad, they're not super tall, as you would expect on a neck like this one. Now, me personally, I would prefer a much taller fret profile like you'd find on the Richie Kotzen Tele, which has a similarly thick neck. In fact, that's probably the closest comparison that I can draw between these two. It is a real serious player's neck for players with big hands, and I would like a taller fret to go along with it, but again, it's not my signature guitar, it's Jared's signature guitar, and it's probably true to some of the modded customs that you're likely to find, like players' customs that have had certain upgrades done to them over the years, like the Grover tuners, and perhaps like a refret with taller wire. And to this effect, you'll notice that the fret tangs actually kind of hang over the edge of our binding, rather than having cream nubs like you'd expect to find on a new off-the-shelf Les Paul. And I think this has a really cool look. It looks like an old guitar that's been played. It's been in the hands of a player, and they've refretted it a couple of times. They put some new tuners on it. It's a very, very cool visual. Now, going down to the headstock, the neck join, it's a set glued-in neck join. There's no visible kind of like join down here. It's really nicely done, very, very positive feeling. Again, super thick neck. It stays about the same thickness all the way up, so it's actually pretty manageable by the time you get to the treble end. It's also your traditional Les Paul kind of curved violin carved body. Excuse all of the fingerprints. I've been having far too much fun playing this guitar, so I've left loads of finger marks all over it. That is the problem with black guitars. Actually, on that subject, the finish is what I would probably refer to as an aged gloss. So it's not a satin finished guitar, but it has a bit of that satin smoothness about it. Now, if you've played any very, very old guitars, specifically old Les Paul, walls or anything that's been finished in nitro a long, long, long time ago, they have a real kind of like particular feel about them. And this guitar has that feel, which is really rather nice. So they've done a great job of making this feel like an old guitar without resorting to any kind of relicking processes, which, you know, kind of that's a bit of a Marmite thing. If we turn it around, we have your traditional Les Paul flat back, but the binding is rounded across the edges. It's not sharp in any way, which you might find on some more affordable guitars of this type shape. 7-ply binding too, which is lovely. You'll notice there's no cutout here because there's no switch. It's a very, very simple electronic circuit. If we turn it back over, of course, it's a single P90 with a master volume and a master tone. It's a Seymour Duncan P90, and this is based on a 1955 P90, as is the whole guitar. It's actually based on a 55 Les Paul with only one pickup. So the guitar it was based on had the neck pickup removed. Actually, talking about things being removed, we've got this wraparound bridge down here, and I'm a big fan of wraparound bridges. It's compensated, so it's going to intonate properly, and this means it's a real simple, real effective design. There's no extra bits to worry about. There's no extra kind of like tailpiece down here. It's going to transfer the vibrations of your strings very positively into the guitar. And also, we have this cool blues power plate down here, which is in the place of our tunematic tailpiece. Now, on Jared's own guitar, which this is based on, originally it was a two-piece bridge. But when he replaced the two-piece bridge with this kind of junior-style bridge, there were two holes here, so he stuck a custom-made plaque on there. Literally said custom-made. But for the signature guitar, it says blues power, which is really rather cool. And once again, one pickup. Master volume, master tone, there's our output jack, and that's pretty much it. So, we've taken a listen to the way this guitar sounds with a lot of distortion. Let's back that down a little bit and we'll explore some tonal possibilities. Now, normally at this point, we do a pickup tour, but we have one pickup to deal with, so we can't really do that. So instead, what we're gonna do is we're gonna throw on more of a classic distortion, and I'm gonna show you how many tones you can get just by manipulating the volume, tone, and where you play on the string. So let's go on a little tour of that now. So if you were concerned about this guitar being a one-trick pony because of its simple control layout, don't be. There are lots and lots of sounds in there. If you're willing to play around, use your imagination a little bit. Now, that's without touching a single control on our amp. Of course, we are playing through our regular Victory VX100 Super Kraken. In this example, we're playing through Gain 1 with the gain turned up quite high on the crunch mode. Now, I will say that this pickup is very, very low output indeed. And to remedy that, what I've done before we start rolling this demo is I've cranked up the pull pieces, which is something that you may wish to do if you're interested in getting a little bit more gain out of your guitar. However, let's compare how it sounds with the pull pieces high versus how it sounds with the pull pieces low. I'm going to play a simple riff and then we'll adjust the pull pieces and compare without changing any other settings with everything else on 10. So let's start with the pull pieces cranked up. It sounds like this. And now with the pull pieces in their stock position. So while it certainly sounds great both ways, for my money, having a little bit more output from those raised pull pieces is a little bit more useful for the kind of guitar that I play. Now, before we finish things up, let's explore this in a few different more contexts. We are going to see how well this guitar deals with a thoroughly clean sounding amp. So we'll switch to the clean channel. We'll play a little bit of that in a moment. We're also going to try some slide and we'll try some drop tuned heavy riffing, which really isn't what this guitar is for, but hey, it might be fun. Who knows? But first of all, clean. So while you might not immediately associate bridge P90s with great clean sounds, through a relatively dark amp like our Victory VX100, it sounds really rather good and there's plenty sparkle and character there for a great convincing old school clean. Now of course it's not going to be your modern super sparkly metal clean. I mean, look at it, of course it's not gonna be, but it is a very convincing clean voice out of a single pickup guitar, which is quite impressive. Now, the next experiment, as promised, we're gonna try some slide lines, and for this, we'll whack a little bit more gain on and we'll see how well this guitar deals with that kind of playing. So the dusky old school character of this guitar is great for slide, especially with a metal slide like a brass slide like we brought out today. But also the tone control has a real interesting throaty character through some gain, which is perfect for emphasizing the vocal sound of slide lines. Now, before we go any further, we're gonna try some detuned heavy riffing. I will say ahead of time that obviously this guitar is not meant to be a metal monster. And as a player, I am also not a metal monster, very much a rock guitar player, so you'll have to excuse any cliched lines that I come out with. I will try my best, but hopefully it'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So while it took almost every drop of gain that our test amplifier has to offer to get us into that metal territory, once we got there, the Old Glory acquitted itself really rather well. And there's a lot to be said for bright, open sounding, low output pickups for metal, especially now that we've wound those Paul pieces up a little bit. Perhaps it is a little too low output for that sort of behavior with the Paul pieces in the stock position, but of course, this is the sort of thing that you would expect to do to tailor a guitar to your playing style. So I wouldn't even consider it a modification necessarily. So there you go, guys. In a nutshell, this is the Jared James Nichols Old Glory Les Paul from our friends at Epiphone. It is a great sounding and of course fantastic looking and feeling instrument at an unbelievably affordable price for what you're getting. It looks like an old guitar, feels like an old guitar, sounds like an old guitar, and of course it's a very unique spec that you can't find anywhere outside of the custom shop, because it's basically a junior dressed and playing like a Les Paul custom, which is super cool. So I've had a lot of fun presenting this one to you today. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive. Once more, this is the Old Glory Jared James Nichols Les Paul from our friends at Epiphone. Easy for me to say. I'll see you next time.